Historian A.J.P. Taylor has made himself at home in several worlds: Oxford University, Fleet Street, television studios, and he now lives in a terraced house in North London. We've talked before we met today, and one thing struck me as quite odd, which is when you said you were not at all interested in yourself.
Well, I meant that strictly in terms of my public image, either on television or in other ways. No, I must say I've never been very introspective. I once tried to write an autobiography, and the only title I could think of for it was an uninteresting story. All of my life's been uninteresting. I have been very interested in things, but one of the things I'm not terribly interested in is how I work or what I... My ideas come out, and there they are. And certainly, having seen myself a great deal on the television screen, actually, I'm quite interested in him, this man on the television screen, but he has absolutely nothing to do with me. I look at his little tricks and think that's overplayed, but he's done a good point there. On the whole, I'm quite ready to applaud him. I mean, he's better than most television performers, that I'm aware of, but it doesn't mean that I'm associated with him in any way.
But you see, it's odd that you say that you're not interested in him, and yet you say that he is vain. You've said that you're a vain person.
Oh, yes. Well, I think that this is why I have picked out of myself a sort of personality to project onto the screen. And he is vain. As I said, as an observer, I'm not very vain. When I look at myself on the screen, I think he's quite a good performer. I'm not really terribly pleased about it. I can't think why he gets so much pleasure from it, because he obviously is enjoying himself. It's a mystery to me.
Tell me this, then. Is it that you're saying that you are interested in your ideas? You must be. I mean, you presumably will read your books from time to time, and you will listen to yourself on television. Is it that you're not interested in the psychology of yourself?
Oh, I'm not interested in that at all, no. No, it's more technical. Occasionally I read it, or I look at some part of a book of mine, usually in order to criticise it and see its defects, and occasionally to be satisfied that, after all, it wasn't as bad as I remember. That's my usual reaction when I read a book. In fact, you know the story of Swift in old age reading The Tale of a Tub, which he'd written as a youngster, and the tears streaming down his cheeks and saying, what a genius I had in those days. Well, when I read some of my early books, I think like that, but as I get along to the later ones, I perhaps find more to criticise or more to be satisfied about without being delighted.
You're not that interested in other people's psychology, either, are you? You're not really interested in what makes people tick. You want to, it seems to me, to detail their actions, to detail their thoughts. Is that right?
Of course, I want to work out what they've been doing, because mainly, you see, I deal with, as an historian, with public affairs. I've never attempted to write a novel because I simply couldn't imagine concentrating on private life. Private life seems to me a subject which concerns the people who live it and nobody else. I would like to have a greater grasp of psychology or more confidence in psychology. But when I read attempts to apply psychology to historical characters, they always seem to me so questionable and, of course, so mistaken. No psychologist in real life would attempt to diagnose how his patient's mind works without having contact with the patient. But we as historians are dealing with people who are dead, or we can, and therefore you can make up any kind of theory and it might work. And as always happens, even without much use of psychology, our judgment of historical characters ranges from very good to very bad, the same sort of people. No, I'm just not very good at it. And I think treating other people's psychology is a mode of invention. I would rather stick to what's within my range, which is an analysis of their ideas, their politics, and their actions.
Who do you think influenced your ideas, your politics in particular, say, from at a very early age?
Ideas and politics are two different things. So far as politics went, I'm afraid I'm a simple case of heredity, that I grew up in a radical household, a household which during the First World War changed into being a socialist household, I took all this for granted, and although there have been plenty of things in which I've modified my views, my basic reactions remained exactly the same. So there's, people sometimes think how wonderful it is, how brave to be a radical, but with me it's exactly the other way around. It would need a great deal of bravery for me, against myself, as it were, not to be a radical.
Your father was a radical. What did he do?
I mean, what did he do?
What did
he
do?
He
was a cotton merchant. Yes.
And then he retired after the First World War, and was then a local Labour politician. He was a Labour councillor and trade unionist, very active in the general strike. But ideas, I'm not, as I suggest to you, I'm not very good on ideas too. I can't understand profound ideas. Philosophy quite beyond me. I think the two people who influenced me most did so because either they were, again, sort of radicals, or very clever in their expressions. One was Samuel Butler, author of Erewhon, a real crank. 9/10 of his ideas were wrong, and the others were not right. And, of course, Bernard Shaw.
Could be called a crank too, perhaps.
Most of Bernard Shaw's writings are of an extreme rationality. In fact, what he suffered from was brains in the head. That he was so much cleverer than anyone else, and he lacked, you see, ordinary human feelings, so that he couldn't understand why people behaved in the erratic and often emotional way they did. But for a young man, he was then infinitely stimulating.
If you were an early dissenter, you must therefore have found it quite easy to not go along with established views like, say, the church. Is that right?
Oh, I think so, yes. It never, as I say, I never was in this position of having to worry about it.
But would your father...
I would go a bit further and say it took me a little time to grow out of the habit of dissenting for the sake of dissenting. Now, when I get all kinds of invitations, say from crank organizations, I reject 9 out of 10 because 9 out of 10 cranky ideas doesn't attract me anymore. Now that I'm a lapsed crank. I don't show the enthusiasm for crankiness I did when I was young. But certainly I've never felt a pressure to conform.
Can I go back to the church, for instance? Does it mean that you never even bothered to go and worship in a church when you were young, that you somehow decided that it was not for you?
I don't think it was ever on offer. I'm trying to think. When I was very young, I was occasionally popped into Sunday school while my parents were not at church, but at the Nonconformist Chapel next door. Mm. And then this very early... they stopped going. The proposition wasn't there. When I was at school, I was at Quaker school, and of course I went to meeting every week. And it's very difficult to dissent, to be a crank over meeting, because all you're asked to do is to go down and sit quiet. And if it wasn't for the slight implication of religion involved, I think I should be a member of the Society of Friends.
What upsets you about even the slightest of implication of religion?
It doesn't concern me. I think it's, if you like, a form of intellectual blindness or deafness that I have. To me, all aspects of religion, all concerns with the supernatural and so on, are a buzzing in the ears that I don't connect.
Nonconformity ought to have appealed to you in a sense, though, because it did throw up quite a lot of dissenters.
Oh, yes, and some of them I admired, but their particular tone of being in close touch with God and knowing better than anyone else didn't appeal to me very much, because what I've tried to be all my life, though I haven't always succeeded, is to be tolerant and to accept other people's rights, to have views different from mine, to have different behaviours from mine. You know what William Morris said, no man is good enough to be another man's master. Mm. And I put it in a different way, that no man's better than me, but I'm not better than anyone else. Mm. And these two guiding rules mean that I'm not going to be told what's good or bad by somebody else. On the other hand, I'm not going to tell it to them. Mm.
Nonconformist views must have been strong in somebody like Lloyd George, for instance. Now, he's a person you admired, and do you think that he is a particularly good example of somebody, A, coming from the people, and you do seem to quite admire that, I think. Am I right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, he didn't come all that much from the people. Mm-hmm. This is an act that he put on. His father, after all, although a poor man, would have been a distinguished schoolmaster. It was only because he died young that his career was interrupted. Well, that puts him a very cultivated man with a big library of books. The uncle that brought Lloyd George up, although referred to as though he was a village cobbler, was in fact the local shoemaker who employed half a dozen men under him. So that he was not on the same level as a colliery worker or even somebody working in the various industries and agriculture of North Wales. But he was humble, yes. And he had escaped, as he said, going through the staff college of either of the ancient universities.
And because of his nonconformity, I imagine that he was also free to break away from the establishment. Wouldn't that be so about him?
Welsh nonconformity was itself an establishment of the most powerful scale.
Right.
And Lloyd George, in lapsing from it, either in his beliefs, because he said himself that he liked singing hymns, he wasn't a Christian anymore, and of course in his behaviour, faced considerable risks, though he always managed to overcome them.
You have been, I've been told by some people, I'm not going to embarrass you with too much about it, but that your teaching, they've experienced it, and it was of an immense nature, they said, right? Leave it at that. I don't want you to comment on that.
No.
But can you remember anybody influencing you, a teacher influencing you, that really got you interested in learning, and in particular learning history?
Well, nobody needed to, because I was interested in history, as it were, before I went to school at all.
How, though? I mean, what made you interested? Do you know?
Ah, I've not the slightest idea.
No.
It seems to me just common sense. Everyone ought to be interested in history. That's what I wanted to read as a boy. Well, not always history, adventure stories about history. Henty, you see, was my favourite author when young. He influenced me more than anyone else because he wrote these lovely historical novels with lovely little maps and diagrams of battles, squares on them showing where the cavalry were and the infantry and so on. And this straightforward routine history, I'm afraid I often write like that myself. More and more I've been lured into interest in history by this kind of practical things. The only substantial work of history that influenced me, I suppose, was H.G. Wells's Outline of History, which I bought when it came out in Fortnightly Parts.
Well, you were sort of, you're an only child, were you not?
Yes.
So were you sort of a big reader, a bit of a loner?
I was a loner child. My father was very deaf, so that although we were a great deal together, walking or later on his driving the car and so on, we rarely conversed. It was difficult to converse with him in the open air because, except on practical topics, shall we go left or right, but I don't think I've ever had an extended discussion with him on anything, because it was technically impossible. And I had very few friends, certainly in my early school. I had friends later on when I was adolescent, but I had no friends in my youth. Nobody came except an occasional cousin, so I spent my time reading.
Mm.
Well, first of all, until I was about three, demanding to be read to. Pilgrim's Progress was my favourite book.
A Christian book?
No, it's an adventure book. It's a dissenter's book. It's a rebel's book. I would still put it very high among the great books of English literature. In fact, I'm not sure it isn't the greatest book I've ever read.
Mm. You see that you talk about history as, am I right in saying this, it's that something you thoroughly enjoy, which you want other people to enjoy, and you do not look for instruction in history. Am I right or am I wrong? You don't seem to be...
I've never crossed my mind one gets lessons from history. I don't want lessons from history. I want to know how it worked, how these things happened, sort it out, make sense of it. It's partly a desire for tidiness to bring a bit of shape into it. Of course, I recognize quite well, all history writing is artificial. All history writing is bound to simplify, to a greater or less extent, a theme, a situation which is infinitely complex. No historian in the world can do justice to his subject, because material is lacking, space is lacking. So it's like drawing a contour on a bit of paper and saying to someone, look, that's Everest. When you go and look at Everest, you realize that there are many problems in Everest that you don't just get a little contour drawn on a map.
So you're saying that we cannot learn anything about the present time by looking at the past?
No, I didn't say that.
But are you saying
that? No, what I said is that I don't learn lessons. Plenty of people, I gather, learn lessons from history. Whether they learn useful lessons, I don't know. In my opinion, situation, you can learn certain things about human behavior, of course. You can learn that nobody's perfect. You can learn that most men who get into power have a combination of ambition, desire to serve their country, and desire to benefit themselves and to come out better than they came in. Or you can learn certain elementary lessons which are much disregarded nowadays, as that the deterrent always, in the end, fails to deter, that any country or any civilization which hopes to prevent war by relying on armaments, what's now called the deterrent, will be destroyed. Mm. This is quite clear. But it's so obvious to me and so boring, and so nothing follows from it. Everybody knows this, and no one acts on it.
But you did say, and I'm going to check your quote on this, you have said that, for instance, if one studied the First World War, we would be in a better position to be captains of our own destiny. So you were looking,
yes.
You were looking at history then to find out something.
No, I'll tell you exactly what I was doing. I was finding a payoff line for a preface.
What do you mean you actually made that up?
Of course. That is the last line of the preface of the First World War Illustrated History. You've got to sell a book somehow.
Now then. That brings me to another thing. History often attracts people because of its heroes, I think, right? I'm going to dodge that one for a minute, because you've just reminded me of something. When I was reading your book on Beaverbrook last night, mm-hmm. You admired Beaverbrook because he made something up in one of his histories. You went to see him about it.
That's right.
Now, why do you admire?
I didn't say I admired him. I said, partly because this was something which I, with a historian's conscience, would never do. And it showed a slightly light-hearted approach to history.
Can you remember the incident?
Yes. It was when Lloyd George was trying to impose convoy on the Admiralty and went down to Admiralty House in order to say to the Board of Admiralty or to the Admirals there, and then Beaverbrook says he took his seat in the First Lord's chair at the head of the Admiralty Board. Mm. And then I add, in fact, there was no meeting of the board that day, and that Beaverbrook had made it up at a very late stage in order to liven the proof. That's perfectly true, and I wouldn't for a moment suggest that every word of Beaverbrook's historical works is factually accurate. But it is, in a sense, accurate, because it's, although he didn't sit himself at the head of the Admiralty Board, it is what happened that day that Lloyd George, in fact, took over control of the Admiralty and insisted that they were going to introduce convoy. So that it's only a more vivid way of putting it.
It intrigues me that Beaverbrook, I mean, I never met him, right? I've only read bits about him. I had made up my mind that he was a monster, right? Now, then I read your book. You love him. You love him.
Oh, yes, I liked him very much.
And then there's Michael Foote, another extreme left-wing person. Adored him as well, or appeared to, or admired him. Yeah. What was it about Beaverbrook that struck us who did not know him as being a monster, and you as a perfectly likable person? Could you see something in him that you wanted to be?
Oh, no, not at all. Because there was an infinite excitement and zest. He was always full of interest in things. He was also could be enormously sympathetic, as Birkenhead called him, a foul-weather friend. But it was simply a zest and interest in life. I mean, it was good to be with him, because if you've got a story of any kind to tell him, either because you were down on your luck or because you'd heard something funny, he would welcome it. And, of course, he disliked the whole sort of panoply of respectability, and he was, in his curious way, a rebel. But I don't know how you can explain it to be so captivated by this strange character. Mind you, I knew him in his older years, when perhaps he wasn't so engaged in being domineering, but all the same, all his the stories where I read about him, worked out from his papers later on, it was the same character, a mixture of hesitance and domination. In fact, I think in his last few years he was at his most domineering over his newspapers, because he'd so much else less to do.
Mm. I quote you again: if you want to peer into the future, listen to what the dissenting minority is saying. Today's idealism is the realism of the future.
That's a historian's comment. It's not that so much that it works now, but I was struck when writing a book on foreign policy and the dissenters, particularly in the 19th century, that the things that they, the line they took, and which was very, they were very shocked about at the time, another 10, 20 years, everybody agrees with it. A very good example, of course, is the end of the First World War and the peace with Germany, the Treaty of Versailles. And at the time, the critics of the Treaty of Versailles were a despised minority, and everyone said it was absolutely disgraceful to take such a line. 10 years afterwards, this had become orthodoxy, and the Foreign Office and the British government were doing their best to undo the Treaty of Versailles. And what followed from that is that they got the Second World War. So which was the wiser, I don't know. But you do get, in all kinds of ways, the acceptance of when the way that to advocate free trade at one time was to be very much a dissenting group, and then it became an orthodoxy, and indeed to go against free trade was then a form of rebellion. It's a rhythm in life. It applies not only in other countries. In this country, it applies in other countries and in other affairs.
That do you think there is a dissenting voice at the moment that you are trying to listen to that will be proved right in 10 years' time?
I think there has been a dissenting voice ever since the war, sometimes very feeble, sometimes carrying a bit more weight. This is true in the United States as well as in this country, totally repudiating the outlook and philosophy of what's called the Cold War. I was an anti-Cold War warrior from the very start. One of my earliest radio experiences was to be turned off the third program because I had criticized the concept of the Cold War, and I hope I've gone on doing it ever since. I think it's been totally mistaken. It's been the wrong way of treating the problem of relations with Soviet Russia, and has brought all kinds of unnecessary troubles on the world. It's said to be dying down now, but I'm not so sure.
You wrote a piece, which I read some while back, and you were bemoaning the fact that you couldn't hear dissenting voices amongst the young.
Well, it goes up and down. As I suppose it always has done, you get waves of dissent. There was a time when there was, after all, the great student movement all over Europe in the late 1960s, and most of it's died away. And when I look back to my last great, in fact, my only really great activity of dissent, which was the campaign for nuclear disarmament, which was a wonderful experience and by far the best thing I ever did in my life, this won over the young. It won over a whole generation, which were passionately concerned and active. And since then, there's been nothing on the same scale.
Does that sadden you or not?
That there's been nothing?
Yeah.
Well, as I say, it goes up and down, but I think it's about time they believed in something.
Well, thank you very much for talking to me today.